there you are. Wondered how long it would be before you put the thing on. Now, as you probably gathered, the video cassette you're playing is no ordinary VHS. It's actually a carrier for one of these, a TM12000 audio digital satellite homing chip. It's a devilish clever little device from our American cousins. Now, it enables me to beam directly into your living room from London via the satellite. Naturally, the one you're carrying is only a prototype, but it does seem to be working rather well. Right. Now, I haven't got all day, so let's get on with it. Elms ordered me to brief you on the world of 007. It goes without saying that the footage in this briefing is highly classified. Let's start with 007's aviation skills. Now, for this, we'll be dealing with Vic Armstrong, British agent, Mark Wolf, US agent, and Dickie Beer, former Dutch national. Every one of these guys are highly experienced Bond campaigners. They really are the best in the field. So please, pay attention.
My name's Vic Armstrong. I'm the second unit director.
I'm Dickie Beer, stunt coordinator.
My name's Mark Wolf, and I'm the aerial coordinator. We're going to do this sequence where they fire the ejector seat from one airplane into the other.
It's going to be shot in the Alps at Paris Sud. I'm Bond. We'll climb into the cockpit here, have a fight with the pilot. Start taxiing the plane around on full bore. Same time, rockets and machine cannon fire is going, so everything here is just being blown to smithereens. People are going to race around behind Bond with a truck here, and he'll just give it full bore on his afterburners and blow this whole truck and people over with the afterburner. Start racing along here. He will then taxi down this really steep runway. He disappears down there. This other jet has started up and is going off in pursuit of him. Bond boy this time will have turned around at the bottom of the runway, and all this is intercut with a cruise missile coming over. It's going to hit here, so he's literally got seconds to spare. Bond will then give it full bore up the runway.
Bond takes off.
Just as he's about to lift off, he sees the other jet coming at him, so he takes off and literally wheels scrape tailplane over the top here as this blast goes off, creating a huge fireball, and we all think, has he gone, hasn't he gone? But we probably think he hasn't, because this is the beginning of the movie.
The baddie is chasing him in another jet. So the baddie is trying to strangle him in the back.
The end of the dogfight. Fire the co-pilot in his ejector seat out of it, and the co-pilot fly into the cockpit of the plane that was chasing him. The co-pilot, who was shot out of Bond's plane, would end up in the other plane with his feet sticking up.
Most of it will be done for real.
The first idea was to use me for that, because A, I'm used to flying and I do aerobatics myself. The G-forces I can sort of handle.
Normal landing for this aircraft is about 100, 120 maximum. And so they're getting very close to their tire blowout speed, and they have to be very careful that they don't hit too hard, otherwise they'll blow a tire and splatter themselves against the runway. We haven't had much chance to practice because the weather, as you can see, has been foul.
I think it's quite funny, actually.
Backseat driver.
Throughout the transmission of this briefing, you must expect to experience a touch of interference from time to time. Now, as I warned, the TM-12000 is just a prototype. Now, I do hope you'll be more understanding than some people I could mention. Now, the next section of this briefing comes from British agent Daniel Kleiman, who's been working closely with 007 for some time now. He's based in London and has one of the best undercover stories of any agent currently in duty. He masquerades as a rock and roll music video director. Now, not only does this enable him access to the latest in computer technology, but it allows him to travel all over the world from location to location, carrying information and equipment between agents and governments without arousing suspicion.
If you're going to do title sequences to movies, then the Bond title sequence is the great iconographic big one of title sequences. It's an adolescent fantasy, and actually to make it is a probably adolescent fantasy come true. What I wanted to get to begin with was this effect that the whole screen smashes open, or like an enormous TV screen that smashes open, and you travel into it, and you travel through a kind of stylized version of what cyberspace might be. We're seeing below the surface of things. In a way, it's seeing behind the news. Darling, I'm killed. This is actually Bond's watch, and it turns into a negative. It's kind of got quite a techno edge to it. There's quite a lot of images that are X-ray images and screens that pull apart and screens that explode, and you see behind. You're seeing behind the images, you're seeing through guns into the X-ray workings of them, and you're seeing behind screens and inside TV sets and inside cyberspace and looking beyond the surface. It looks like she kind of pulls out of this circuit diagram that we've seen growing across the screen. It's all girls this time. I decided not to put a Bond character in. There are certain elements in Bond that you can't throw out. This girl fires a bullet. Again, we're in sort of some sort of strange X-ray world. Bullet then starts smashing all these floating TV screens. And that reveals through to a world of smoky women. They're kind of floating through smashed up screens. You've got these girls made out of smoke, which eventually you realize is smoke coming from a gun. Then we're back in the X-ray gun world. Start of the film opens up with, it's like a car boot sale of guns, and this vaguely has reference to that. What I originally intended was to reflect the feeling of communication and technology and satellites and mass media in a sort of abstract, surreal way. It reveals, the screens reveal this girl, and these diamonds fly off her neck and become like satellites around the world. Things have moved on, I'm trying to make it more modern. She falls through all these screens, there's more cyberspace stuff, and as she's falling towards this great, enormous TV screen, the ultimate music video crossed with your ultimate adolescent fantasy.